The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. It was the ancient Greeks who believed that man's life is a thread, and it passed through the hands of three goddesses who were called the Fates. The thread spun by Clotho, the design was determined by Lachesis, and then there was Atropos, who waited with the terrible shears. And when she snipped the thread, for a good reason, or a bad reason, or no reason at all, that was the end. Forever. And therefore, everyone who takes another's life also takes upon himself the mission of Atropos. And since, in a divine sense, she is the only one who is licensed to perform that duty, she may not take kindly to competition. Bear it in mind.
Are you trying to bribe me?
Of course.
I have never been so insulted.
You've never been so flattered. How important you've suddenly become. A mere girl like you can now control the destiny of thousands. How much money do you want?
There isn't enough money in the world.
Oh, there is, there is. We'll give you $1 million.
But...
Take the million, my dear. Take it, or we'll have to kill you.
Our mystery drama, The Mission of Atropos, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Sam Dan and stars Mason Adams. It is sponsored in part by Sinoff, the Sinus Medicines, and Buick Motor Division. I'll be back shortly with Act One. I swear by Apollo, physician, that I will fulfill, according to my ability and judgment, this oath and covenant. Thus begins the celebrated oath of Hippocrates. For thousands of years, the ethical standard and spiritual guide for practitioners of the medical profession. Louisa Alcott Mandeville is a young doctor, and the oath is still fresh and inspiring. A framed copy of it hangs in her office, where she looks at it from time to time every day.
I'm looking for Dr. Mandeville.
I'm Dr. Mandeville.
You're Dr. Mandeville? No.
I see that's become my name around here, Dr. Mandeville O.
Well, who figures...
A dame.
It ain't that. You know, ladies who are doctors, but you figure they're all old dames.
You should also figure that all old dames were once young dames.
Yeah, that figures.
What's your name?
Barney. Bernard Aloysius Kremen. I work at the reduction plant.
Why don't you do something about that cough?
Like what?
Well, you could stop smoking, for one thing.
I can't.
All it takes is a little willpower.
How can I stop when I never smoked in my life? Caught you that time.
Very good. Well, what's wrong?
I don't know what's wrong. That's why I come to you.
I don't like that cough.
I don't like it either.
How long have you had it?
6 weeks, a couple of months, maybe.
Mm-hmm. Is it painful?
Well, I get a little wave.
Wave.
It took me a long time to figure it out. Like a wave. Like you go to the beach, see a wave, kind of rolls in and builds up higher and higher, and it just breaks. I get this wave.
Does it hurt?
No, it's like pressure.
Where?
Everywhere. All over, all at once. I want to tell you, Doc, it's scary. And then right in the middle of it... Off.
The wave. It happened just now?
Yeah.
Take off your shirt, please.
What's the verdict, Doc?
I don't know.
Well, it's what I figured.
I need more time.
Be my guest.
Do you cough like that all the time?
I do lately.
I would like to send you to the hospital for observation.
No, Dice. I can't afford it.
Well, you could take it out of sick leave. You'd still be paid.
Yeah, but that's just straight pay. I'm not only knocking off time and a half overtime, but double time for Saturdays and Sunday. The way the plant is smoking now, I can't afford to give that up.
Thursday, October 15th. The patient's name is Bernard Aloysius Kremen. White male, aged 54. Married, 3 children. No serious prior illnesses. Complains of some sort of malaise. Persistent dry cough. Pulse, blood pressure, heartbeat normal. Routine EKG, X-ray, blood test negative. Come in.
Dr. Mandeville, you haven't had your dinner.
Oh, thank you, Mrs. Drake.
Well, now, is that wise?
No, I don't think so, Mrs. Drake. I have this work to finish.
Oh, talking into that tape recorder, Dr. Mandeville. Do it on company time.
No, I'll be down in a little while.
Doctor, did I overhear you say something about Barney Kremen?
Well, yes, he's my patient at the factory.
Was your patient, you mean? He died.
He what?
He died.
Barney Kremen?
He dropped dead this afternoon, right after he come home from work.
But that's impossible. Friday, October 16. Bernard Kremen, a man who in every respect seemed normal except for the cough, expires suddenly. A post-mortem performed immediately after at the hospital reveals absolutely no further information. Pathologists could find no tissue damage. Why did he die? And what caused it? Dr. Mandeville? What's that? Where? The reduction plant. No. No, don't lift him. Don't move him. Call an ambulance. I'll be right there. Everybody, move away, please. Please, give him some air. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
How do you feel?
As if I were on a wave.
You have any pain?
It's just a wave, you know. I go up, I go down. I'm going to die. I know that.
That cough, how long have you had it?
The cough. Barney Kremen and I. It can kill you.
Oh, now, try to lie still, please. What can kill you?
The KCV 447.
The what?
The KCV 447. I found that out. They're not supposed to use it.
What is KCV 447?
Don't let me die. Please, don't let me die.
I'm going to have to give you a shot. It won't hurt.
KCV 447. Remember?
Saturday, October 17. Patient's name, Jack Edward Caddy. White male, age 25. Graduate student working his way through school. Unmarried. Displayed same signs, described same symptoms as Bernard Kremen, especially the cough. Became delirious, lapsed into coma en route to hospital, and died on arrival. Post-mortem performed. No indication of cause of death. Spoke of substance called KCV 447. Check on it.
Please, sit down, Doctor. Well, how's the job coming?
Mr. Spaulding, I wanted to...
I must say that the board of directors didn't take kindly to the idea of a woman doctor for plant physician. Stodgy group.
Mr. Spaulding, in the past week, 2 men have died in the reduction plant.
Yes, yes, I was informed. What was the cause of death?
We're not sure.
Not sure?
Mr. Spaulding, what is KCV 447?
KCV 447? It sounds like someone's license plate.
Mr. Spaulding, this plant is filling a government contract.
Oh, I hope you won't talk about that on the outside, Dr. Mandeville. It's top secret.
Our current project is constructing motors for nuclear reactors.
Now, Dr. Mandeville, really, you
I'm sorry, sir. This is germane to the discussion.
What sort of discussion are we having?
As the plant physician, I have been issued a list of government prohibited materials. These are all hazardous substances which cannot be used since they constitute a danger to health and life. Violations will result in cancellation of contracts, plus possible criminal prosecution.
Doctor, what is all this to do with me?
KCV-447 has been used and is being used in this plant.
Dr. Mandeville, I can state categorically that is not true.
And I say it is, Mr. Spaulding.
Do you have evidence for such a serious charge?
Yes.
May I ask, what is that evidence?
The evidence of my own eyes. I paid a visit to the supply warehouse, and I asked Mr. What's-his-name, Marlowe, I believe, if we had any KCV-447. And he said he wasn't supposed to give out any information like that. But when I identified myself as the plant doctor, he said in that case it must be okay. You have cartons of it. Well, Mr. Spaulding...
The old fool. The labels were supposed to... Well, it seems I'm caught red-handed. The next move?
Two men are already dead. There's no way of telling how many more will die because you have used a prohibited substance. I shall report this to the authorities.
Yes, that's one course of action. Another, you could forget about it.
Forget about it?
I could make it worth your while.
Are you trying to bribe me?
Of course.
I have never been so insulted.
Oh, and never been so flattered. How important you've suddenly become. Here you are, a fledgling doctor, still in your 20s, and you hold the fate of a $200 million project in your delicate hands.
Do you know what you're saying?
Listen carefully. I'm saying life is short. Timing is exact. Experience is treacherous, and judgment is difficult. I offer you $1 million.
There isn't enough money in the world.
Yes, there is. All we have to do is negotiate and arrive at the price.
There is nothing you and I have to negotiate.
But there is something you should negotiate with yourself. You have arrived at a crossroad in your life.
That is not true.
You can alter the course of your entire existence. I notice you drive an Isotta Asmara, a very expensive sports car.
It's a luxury I afford myself.
Take a day or two.
And do what?
Think about it.
I've already thought about it.
KCV-447 is an exotic. There's absolutely no proof it's harmful.
Then why is it on the prescribed list?
My dear doctor, you know how vocal these do-gooders are. Doctor, even those who are violently opposed to KCV-447 admit it can only be lethal to a very small number of people.
One person is enough.
And these would have to be people who have a very rare protein allergy.
In this plant alone, it has already struck down two people that we know of. The toll can rise higher.
Doctor, if indeed KCV-447 is the culprit... Now, look, we have no real facts. But here is what I'm willing to do. I'm sorry about those two men. Anonymously, quietly, I'll send money to their families.
Will you stop using KCV-447?
Oh, doctor, I can't, unfortunately. You see... It's a drying agent. It dries various component parts twice as fast as any other known process. Therefore, it cuts my fabricating time in half, also my costs. That's why I was able to underbid all my competition for this job.
Well, I don't think we have anything further to say to each other, Mr. Spaulding. It's a Saturday afternoon. I shall spend tomorrow on my analysis and present what I know to the government on Monday morning.
You may regret your action, Dr. Mandeville.
I'm a doctor to whom life is precious. I'm also a citizen for whom the law must be supreme.
You are also a phrase maker.
Good day, sir.
Not to mention a pompous little fool. Which reminds me, one of our great Americans said, experience runs a hard school, but fools will learn at no other. I'm afraid, Doctor, that there may be a very... hard lesson awaiting you.
Smooth as satin, sweet as honey. That's how Fred Spaulding comes on. But do you suspect an iron fist inside that velvet glove? You could be right. Dr. Mandeville has decided to take action on Monday morning. But that's almost 2 days away. 2 days can be a lifetime, an eternity. I shall return shortly with Act Two. Well, our first act ended with a young lady doctor who had some damaging evidence that could destroy the fortunes of a powerful industrialist. And she was going to present that evidence to the authorities on a Monday morning. I regret to say that she never did. It is with even greater sorrow that I must inform you that we shall never see Dr. Louisa Alcott Mandeville again in this life. Why? Well, it is Sunday evening, and we are in a police station.
Well, well, well. What are you doing here, Richard Harding Davis?
Richard Harding Davis? That sure dates you, Lieutenant Carey. How about Floyd Gibbons?
Well, now, they were reporters. They died before punks like you were even born.
I'm sorry.
You're covering the station house tonight?
Yes, sir, Lieutenant Carey. Alfred Alexander Marks Times Union at your service.
Lieutenant Carey. Yeah. Uh-huh. Okay, let me write it all down. Victim's name. Yeah, make a car. Uh-huh. Right. Get the report in. Yeah.
What was that?
Nothing you're going to win the Pulitzer Prize for. Dame killed herself in an auto accident. Smashed into the concrete wall of an underpass. Kills herself and totals the car. One of those foreign jobs, an Isada Asmara.
You're kidding, an Isada Asmara? I drive one of those.
And your salary?
I got it 15th hand. She wrecked an Isada? Hey, let's have the details. She must have been an heiress.
You'll never guess, so I'll tell you. She was a doctor, company doctor at the Spaulding plant. About 30 years old, name of Louisa Alcott Mandeville.
With that name, she must have been a real hatchet face.
And don't try to make Grandpa Carey here think you're tough. You want more facts, you can pick up her bio from personnel at the factory.
Can you imagine somebody totaling an Isada Asmara?
Al Marks, who's the reporter?
Do you know what time it is?
Sure, it's 12 o'clock noon.
Well, it's my day off, so whoever you are, don't bother me.
Al, it's me, Frank. Frank the Junkie.
Frank the Junkie?
Yeah, I own the junkyard over in South Maine.
Oh.
Hey, Al, you still looking for a master brake cylinder for that sports car of yours?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, this car, exactly like yours, Isada Asmara, got itself totaled a couple of 3 days ago. Killed a dame driving it. The master cylinder might be worth looking at. What do you say?
I'm on my way.
This is her, Al. The Isada Asmara.
Now I remember. I was filling in for the guy who had the police beat that night. Cops said she must have lost control and run off the road. I wrote up the story. She was a doctor. Young, too. Alone in the world.
That happens all the time. So, you want to take the master cylinder out and look at it? Be my guest. Is it okay, Al?
Yeah, it's okay, I guess.
Go figure. You can pick that up at a junkie's. It's got to be my lucky day or yours. What are you staring at?
It's a piece of tubing. It's part of the brake line. It carries the fluid from the master cylinder to the brake.
I know what it does.
You know what I think, Frank? I think it's been cut.
What?
Deliberately cut.
Why would anybody want to do that?
So that all the brake fluid would spill out, which would mean that in a little while there'd be no brakes, and if you were going downhill or around a curve, goodbye.
Yeah, but why?
Maybe somebody wanted that young lady doctor have an accident.
What are you building, Al?
This end of the line, Lieutenant. You see, it's been deliberately sawed through or cut through.
Al, you wouldn't be out to create some news now, would you?
What are you trying to say, Lieutenant Carey?
Sunday night, what was the story worth? One paragraph buried somewhere in Monday's paper. But now, what if you could get a whole week out of it, huh? Week on the front page in your byline every day.
I don't know what you're talking about.
It's a normal, natural way for a hungry young reporter to behave. Here's your first headline. Foul play suspected in woman doctor's death.
All I want is to determine if this brake line was deliberately cut, and if it was, this becomes just as much your business as mine.
So, what do you want me to do?
Send it to the police lab.
Oh, the police lab. That's where the miracles happen. That's supposed to be the last word.
Are you going to send it to the lab or not?
Okay, I'll send it to the lab.
I don't know if I should talk to you, Mr.
Marks. Marks, I'm with the Times Union. It's a fine paper.
Oh, I know it is. I'm a subscriber. Couldn't get through my day without Times Union. But why do you want to know about Dr. Mandeville?
Mrs. Drake, I'm going to level with you. I think she was murdered.
But she was killed in an accident.
It was no accident. The car was tampered with.
By whom? Now, who could have done it? A thing like that? Why?
I was hoping you could tell me.
Well, tell you what.
About her friends, to start with.
Well, she didn't have any. She worked all day, came home, worked half the night, and went to bed.
Men?
No, since she's living here, nobody.
Phone calls?
None.
What did you know about her?
Well, nothing.
You mean she didn't talk about herself?
Oh, she did. It added up to nothing. Comes from California, originally. Folks died when she was born, raised by an elderly aunt. Never played much with other kids. She read a lot, went to college and medical school on scholarships. Never did anything in her whole life but work and study.
Well, what about her things?
Well, she had her clothes and a few personal items. She got in touch with this old aunt of hers on the phone out in California. What do you want me to do with her stuff, I asked. Keep it, the old lady answered. Now, I think she's senile.
Could I look through some of it?
Well...
Look, Mrs. Drake, I'm on her side. You know that.
Well, okay. But I don't think you'll find anything. Well, I told you, Mr. Marks. It'd be just slim pickings.
This tape recorder.
Oh, yeah, the tape recorder. Oh, she came home and made notes of all her cases.
Let me switch it on.
The patient's name is Andrea Detweiler, age 46, white female, married, 2 children. History of ulcers.
Yeah, I see what this is.
Oh, she's got a whole carton of tape here. You could spend days listening to all that stuff.
Maybe I better do that. You mind if I borrow the recorder and all those tapes?
Well, I don't know why I should object.
Mrs. Drake, did she seem upset lately?
Upset? No.
Nervous? Apprehensive? Out of sorts?
Well, I don't know what to say. Well, you see, last week, 2 of her patients at the factory died, you know?
No, I didn't.
Well, she took it kind of hard. Not that it was her fault, I guess.
Tell me something. When she left the house Sunday evening, do you know where she was going?
Oh, yes, she told me. Matter of fact, she said she was going to drive all night to get there in the morning.
Get where?
Washington.
Why would she be going to Washington?
Well, I think she said she was going to see some government people.
Who?
Well, I don't know.
Must have been important if she was going to drive all night.
Well, yeah. When she walked out of here, she had the look of a person who meant business.
What does the lab report say, Lieutenant Carey?
Like I suspected, everything or nothing.
Let's have it.
Well, on the one hand, it could have been sawed through.
You see?
On the other, could have broken due to the high impact of the crash. I'm not sure.
But it could have been sawed through.
Oh, sure. And then again, it didn't have to be.
Look, she was headed for Washington, D.C. when she got killed. I spoke to the landlady.
All right.
All right, what? Isn't there anything you want to do about this?
Do about what? A girl gets killed in a car crash.
The car was tampered with.
That's only an assumption. It's not enough for us.
Yeah, well, it's enough for me.
You think there's a story here, Al?
Yes, Mrs. Rogers, I do.
Well, why?
The brake line was tampered with.
Well, that hasn't been definitely established.
But there are grounds for suspicion. Look, Mrs. Rogers, a quiet, almost a mousy little doctor, keeps completely to herself, no other life but her job, dies under circumstances that might be, I'm saying might be, suspicious. Is it worth a shot?
You have a hunch, haven't you, Al?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. I know what it is to be on your side of the disc with a strong hunch. See what you can run down.
Oh, yes, the Times Union. Your publisher, Mrs. Letitia Rogers, is a warm personal friend of mine.
Mr. Spaulding, I want to talk to you about Dr. Louisa Alcott Mandeville.
Oh, sad. Very sad. A tragic thing.
What do you know about her?
Oh, the surface things. What it said on her resume. She was very quiet, kept to herself, very efficient. May I ask why you're interested?
I have an idea. She was murdered.
What? The car crashed, as I understand it.
It could be established that the car might have been made to crash.
Well, that's certainly a shocking thing to contemplate.
I have an idea that the answer is here in this factory.
Here? Why would you say that?
Because she seemed to have no other interest, no other activity in life. Did you know she was headed for Washington when she was killed?
No. How did you find that out?
Her landlady told me. She was headed for Washington. She had told the landlady she was going to see some government people, and she seemed quite angry.
Yeah, all of this is news to me.
Did you know that two men died here last week?
I was informed, yes.
What did they die of?
Well, that information would be available at the hospital.
Weren't you interested in finding out?
Well, I was, but no one seemed to know.
Would the late Dr. Mandeville have known?
I'm not sure I follow all this, Mr. Marks.
A doctor employed in a factory that is working on a government project leaves home rather angrily one night and heads for some government bureau in Washington, evidently to report a violation.
Oh, you seem to be drawing a long bow.
And I think I'm on target, too. As a doctor, what would she be angry about? The death of those two men?
Do you intend to print any of these mad speculations in the newspaper?
There must be something wrong in this factory from the standpoint of health and safety.
Hadn't you better establish that as a fact first?
Oh, it's a fact, all right. I just don't know where the evidence is. But it exists. I'll find it.
Mr. Marks, what I'm about to say is off the record, and you'll never be able to prove I said it. Who would believe you? Now, look, I'm at a crucial stage of a top-priority project. I might also add that the security of our country depends on it, not to mention the jobs of 6,000 people in this fair city.
Are you building up to what I think you are?
Absolutely. Now, I simply cannot afford to have publicity and disruption and all kinds of inspectors messing about. So, how much do you want to stop being a nuisance?
I can't be bought.
Rhetoric. It's so important when you're young.
I mean it. I intend to go full steam ahead.
That's because you have so little experience in the ways of the world, Mr. Marks. Speaking of experience, was it Ben Franklin who said, experience keeps a hard school, but fools will learn at no other?
Well, we heard that one before. And it was followed by a fatal car crash. Al Marks has been offered the same deal Mr. Spaulding was willing to give Dr. Louisa Mandeville. And Al has turned it down also. Now what? Can we expect another automobile accident? I shall return shortly with Act 3. Truth, it is said, shall prevail in the end. How much better it would be if truth could prevail in the beginning, could save so much trouble, and it might be much safer for those people who are determined to live with it. Who knows? Dr. Louisa Mandeville might still be alive today. Certainly life would be simpler for reporter Al Marks if he could get certain people to believe him.
We've got him, Lieutenant Carey.
Got who?
Spaulding.
For what?
For the whole thing. He tried to bribe me.
Oh, well, you can't prove that.
In a court of law, no, but he did it. He offered me money to lay off.
It would be your word against his.
And whose word would you take, Lieutenant Carey? Look, he tried to bribe me. That means he killed her or had her killed. Naturally, he wouldn't work on her brakes with his own hand.
But how?
You know I'm telling the truth. On what I say alone, I know there's no case, but it should be enough to start you guys off.
What do you want me to do?
The reverse. Usually the evidence leads you to the killer. This time the killer has to lead you to the evidence.
Al, I need more.
It was done, so the evidence is out there. Now it's your job to find it.
How?
Assign men to do it.
I have to have a reason. I just can't put guys out.
Lieutenant, it could be you're afraid to tangle with somebody the size of Spaulding.
Now, don't try that psychology stuff on me. Wait a second. Lieutenant Carey. Who? Yeah, he's here. Huh? Okay, I'll tell him. That was your publisher's office. She wants to see you.
All right.
Don't sound good.
What doesn't sound good?
I think you're going to get some heat.
What do you mean?
You could be stepping on somebody's toes.
Spaulding's?
What do you think?
Then I'm right. You agree I'm right?
Sure you're right. For all the good it's going to do you.
Mr. Spaulding was rather upset with you this morning, Al.
Well, not as upset as I was with him. He tried to bribe me.
I don't believe that.
Let's say you don't want to believe that.
Oh, Al, you are a good reporter. But all you've got are hunches.
The sawed-through brake line?
Not conclusive. The lab will not commit itself.
The two men who died?
A coincidence.
Why would she be headed to Washington, D.C. to talk with some government people? What would she have to talk about if not some violation at the plant?
Al, how do we know she was angry? How do we know she was going to the government? How do we even know she was headed for Washington?
Her landlady told me.
Well, will her landlady put it in writing?
No, but Mrs. Drake.
Look, I told you everything I know.
Well, all I'm asking you to do is let me put it in writing. You said she went to Washington, D.C.
I said she went to Washington. Didn't have to be D.C. Could have been Washington State.
Why would she go there?
Because she comes from there, the West Coast.
You said she was going to meet some government people. You said she walked out of here like a person who meant business.
I don't remember saying that.
All right. How much did he offer you? Al Marks. Yes, Mrs. Rogers. No, Mrs. Rogers. I was unable to get her to give me anything in writing. Well, she reneged on the story. He must have gotten to her. Yes, Mrs. Rogers. Yeah, I'll report to the managing editor for another assignment. But you and I know Spaulding's guilty. And if you can live with it, I wish you luck. What am I out to do? Get myself fired?
Listen, kid. I believe that brake line was hacksawed. I believe he tried to bribe you. I believe he got to the landlady.
Do you, Lieutenant?
I tried to work on it. I had guys out trying to run down leads. Look, if he'd had the brakes tampered with, he'd have had to do it between Saturday afternoon and Sunday night when she was scheduled to leave. Which means it had to be done in the darkness on Saturday night. Now, I had guys checking the neighborhood for anything that looked suspicious.
And?
Nothing turned up.
I don't know what to do.
Well, I wish you did. Because you have to come up with something, anything, so that I can justify putting the men out. What do you got?
Nothing.
Well, you gotta have something. I've got that tape recorder.
It's miles and miles of tapes, diagnoses, medications.
Go through it.
But that could be a career.
You sold me the idea she was killed because she was acting like a doctor. Well, on those tapes, she's talking like a doctor.
Displayed same signs, described same symptoms as Bernard Kremen. See tape. Yesterday's date.
Bernard Crumman. He had... Okay, I remember. Go ahead, Louisa.
Especially the cough spoke of substance called KCV-447. Check it.
KCV-447. KCV-447.
KCV-447. A rapid drying agent suspected of having lethal properties. Its use is prohibited. Attacks certain persons who have a specific protein allergy. Not much known. It causes death in 6 weeks. Only sign is a persistent dry cough and a rising and falling feeling of pressure.
Yes, indeed. We've got him. We've got Mr. Spawning. Oh, yes. No wonder he was willing to pay off.
Lieutenant Carey.
It's me, Al Marks. Listen, Lieutenant, I want to let you know you were right about the tapes.
Yeah?
What I got here is dynamite, and I haven't even heard half of it yet. Look, it'll take me the rest of the night to get all of it. And then I want to meet you at headquarters, and I'll bring my publisher.
Is it good stuff?
When you hear it, you'll know why she was killed and who had the motive.
Jack Edward Caddy, a graduate student in chemistry, worked formerly for International Solvents. They were cited for using KCV-447. It is reasonable to assume, therefore, that Jack Caddy may have suspected the use of KCV-447 at Spaulding's. But once he had caught the illness, it was too late. He must have known because he told me he was dying.
This is dynamite.
The disease caused by KCV-447... is so rare, it has not yet been named. It has a destructive but invisible effect on the heart and lungs. Its only symptoms are the dry, hard cough and the roller coaster feeling of pressure. Once these appear, however, the disease has already taken hold and its fatal course is irreversible.
Yep, I guess that's all of it. Louisa Alcott Mandeville, you were a great lady, and you didn't die in vain. I wish I'd have met you before. Well, I'm going to get my first good night's rest in over a week, and tomorrow morning we cook the goose of Mr. Spaulding. I thought I would tell you two people first.
Yes, go ahead, Al.
What have you got?
Here's what we've got. A prohibited substance called KCV-447. Spaulding uses it to get an unfair manufacturing advantage over his competition. It kills people who have a certain protein allergy. And two such people we know about already died in that plant.
These are facts?
It's all here on the tape. Her words, her voice, summing it up. She finds out about it. You'll hear how. She confronts Spaulding. He tries to bribe her. She announces she's going to report him. The next night, she's dead in a car accident that's at least suspicious.
That's what you've got on the tape?
That's what I've got on the tape.
Well, we'll print every word of it.
It's enough to make an arrest. Roll that tape.
Here goes.
Well?
Something's wrong. Maybe I don't have the cassette on right.
Well, it seems to be running smoothly.
Have you got the right button pushed
down? Something's wrong.
Well, run it fast forward. See where the voice begins.
Something's wrong.
Al?
Al, are you sure?
Listen to me. Listen to me, both of you. Listen. I had it all here on tape, here on this recorder last night. I had it. I swear I had it.
Well, I'm sure you did. But where is it now?
I don't know. I do know. Spaulding, he got it erased somehow.
Al, you are becoming paranoid on the subject of Spaulding.
But it's true.
Ah, Mr. Al Marks, our fine young journalist. Have a seat.
Mr. Spaulding, I came here to tell you that no matter what anyone else believes, I know you killed Louisa Mandeville.
Not true, my boy.
You had her killed.
A reporter should have respect for the truth. Now, that's better.
You had someone fix the brakes.
Correct.
I'm sure if federal inspectors searched your warehouse for KCV-447, they wouldn't find any.
Of course not.
Somehow you got the tape erased on the recorder. I don't know how you did that.
I had a tap put on your telephone. When you told Lieutenant Carey you had all that information on tape, the proper steps were taken while you were fast asleep.
You won't get away with it. I'll spend the rest of my life if I have to, but I'll get the goods on you.
Oh, that's nonsense, and you know it. You know you can't get the goods on me because they no longer exist.
Nobody gets away with murder.
Oh, that's a slogan. If it makes you feel any better, believe it. People like me get away with murder all the time. It's our business. We know how to do it. You know a man like me cannot be brought down by a little man like you or a woman like Dr. Mandeville. I can't be brought down at all. And you know I'm telling the truth. Well, you're almost ready to burst into tears because I've completely demolished everything you wanted to believe about the law of compensation, the ultimate triumph of justice. None of that's true now, is it? Well, is it? What are you laughing at? What's so funny?
How long have you had that cough?
What are you talking about?
I shouldn't have laughed. It isn't funny.
Why is it funny? What are you talking about?
Maybe, just maybe, I'm talking about justice.
Exactly 6 weeks later, the headline in the Times Union informed the world that internationally famous industrialist Charles McNeil Spaulding had died suddenly. The story was written by reporter Al Marks, who quoted the doctors as saying that Mr. Spaulding's death was a mystery. Perhaps, but not to Al Marks. I'll be back shortly. We live our lives by the narrowest of tolerances, by the smallest of gauges. Little accidents, coincidences, chance encounters, sudden hunches. Any one of these can change a life or even decimate the earth. The world is such a volatile, unpredictable, capricious, and giddy place. Can there possibly be a master plan behind it all? Our cast included Mason Adams, Joan Lovejoy, Jackson Beck, Joan Shea, and Robert Maxwell. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown.
Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Anheuser-Busch Incorporated, brewers of Budweiser. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.